remembering tonight is to remember Sunday, to remember Easter and the resurrection. And that gives us great joy. So we can look forward to that. This evening, if you were here last year, you have some idea of our service, but the idea is that we are going to walk through the passages that lead up to the crucifixion and just slightly thereafter. We will be doing the Lord's Supper. That's open to anyone who has been saved and is, is comfortable in their Christian faith. There's singing, and we'll be looking for everyone to join us in that. There's also reader four. There'll be four readers tonight. And reader four, who's Sarah, Savastano, by the way, she will be reading passages that directly after that passage, and it'll be on the screen, there's a response for all of us. So when that pops up, we'll be looking for everyone to respond to that. At the end of the service, the lights are going to be, actually the lights will be dimmed shortly, but at the end of the service, the idea is to leave in silence. So you'll see Will walk out, and you just follow us out. The purpose of tonight is a very quiet service, so if anyone has a cell phone they haven't forgotten to shut off, feel free to do so. Also, and just a reminder, Sunday morning, we have our services as usual at 10:30. However, we also have the children singing, and we have a group of them, I believe. We have a fair crowd this Sunday, so that's going to be something to look forward to. And it's just a joyous morning. So please feel free to be here and bring your friends. Let me just open us in a prayer this evening. Heavenly Father, tonight we celebrate or we worship the greatest gift ever given to mankind. You gave up your Son on the cross for us, not for anything he did or anything you did, but for everything we've done, for everything man has done wrong on this earth. We didn't deserve it, we didn't earn it, yet your love gave us this present. We can never forget this, Lord. We must never forget it. We owe our lives, we owe everything to you, Lord. Lord, I thank you and praise you for this. Lord, as we go through the service tonight and service on Sunday, I ask you to just help us to remember just how big a gift that you gave us, Lord, what you've done for us, that we can keep it close in our hearts. I ask you, Lord, to be with us tonight, be in this building, be with those that are still in reach, so that we all can feel just feel your love, Lord, feel the strength of your Spirit. I ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
My iniquity.
My sin.
My transgressions.
And mine.
Your iniquity.
Your sin.
Your transgressions.
The Lord has laid on him
the iniquity of us all.
Beginning was the Word.
And the Word was with God.
The Word was God.
He was with God in the beginning.
God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not overcome it. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He comes into the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him.
When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness."
Jesus said, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God didn't send the Son into the world that the world might be condemned through him, but rather that the world might be saved by him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned. Whoever does not believe will not see life. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil.
Like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all, laid the deep darkness of sin on the light of the world. God have mercy.
It is the darkness of my sin that shrouded the light of the world. Christ, have mercy.
On the first day of the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus.
Where do you want us to prepare the meal for your Passover?
Go into the city and see a certain man and tell him, the teacher says, my appointed time is near. I'm going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.
So the disciples did as Jesus directed them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, Jesus spoke to them.
I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me.
They were very sad and began to say to him one after another, "Surely not I, Lord."
"Surely not."
"Surely not I, Lord."
"The one who has dipped his hand in the cup with me will betray me."
"Even my close friend, whom I trusted, he who shared my bread, has lifted his heel against me." The word of the Lord from Psalm 41, verse 9.
Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said,
"Surely not I, Rabbi."
"Yes, it is you."
While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to the disciples.
Thank you.
had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. The darkness of unbelief. God have mercy.
It is the darkness of my sin that shrouded the light of the world. Christ, have mercy.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus asked his disciples to stay at a certain place while he went to pray. He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled.
My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow, even to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch.
Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from him.
Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me. It not what I will, but what you will.
An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. The darkness of the Spirit's agony, God have mercy.
It is the darkness of my sin that shrouded the light of the world. Christ, have mercy.
When he came back, he again found them sleeping. So he left them and went away once more and prayed a third time.
My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away from me unless I drink it, may your will be done.
Then he returned to the disciples.
Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour is near, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Here comes my betrayer.
While he was still speaking, Judas arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them.
The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him.
Going at once to Jesus, Judas kissed him.
Greetings, Rabbi.
Friend, do what you came for.
The men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear.
Put your sword back in its place. All who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I cannot call upon my Father, who would immediately produce 12 legions of angels at my disposal? But then how would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen this way?
Jesus touched the high priest's servant and healed him. Then he turned to the crowd.
Am I leading in rebellion that you come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I was in the temple teaching and you did not arrest me. But this has taken place that the scriptures might be fulfilled.
Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.
Was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before the shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. The darkness of betrayal, God have mercy.
It is the darkness of my sin that shrouded the light of the world. Christ, have mercy.
This very night, you will all fall away on account of me. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee.
Peter spoke up.
Even if all fall away on account of you, I never will.
I tell you the truth. This very night, before the cock crows, you will disown me three times.
But Peter continued,
Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you.
And the other disciples said the same.
After Jesus had been arrested and taken to the house of the high priest, Peter was sitting out in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him. "You were also with Jesus of Galilee," she said.
"I don't know what you're talking about."
Then he went out to the gateway, where another girl saw him and said to the people there, "This fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth."
"I don't know the man."
After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, "Surely you are one of them, for your accent gives you away."
"I tell you, I do not know the man."
Then Peter remembered the words of Jesus had spoken, "Before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times." And he went outside and wept bitterly.
Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. The darkness of denial, God have mercy.
It is the darkness of my sin that shrouded the light of the world. Christ, have mercy.
After Jesus was arrested, he was brought to the high priest, the teachers of the law, and the elders. they looked for false evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death. They did not find any, though. Many false witnesses came forward. Finally, they accused him of blasphemy, for Jesus said to them that he was the Christ. They bound him and brought him to the governor, Pilate. Jesus gave no answer to Pilate's questions. When Pilate asked the crowd what they would like to do with Jesus, they responded, "Crucify him." For the chief priests and elders had persuaded them. Fearful of a riot, Pilate handed Jesus over to be crucified. The governor's soldiers took Jesus and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand and knelt in front of him and mocked him.
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him.
When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him, nailing his hands and feet to the cross, standing it upright. After they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots, and sitting down, kept watch over him there. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Jesus saw his mother there, and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby. He said to his mother,
"Dear woman, here is your son."
Turning to his disciple, he said,
"Here is your mother."
Over his head, they placed the written charge against him: "This is Jesus, King of the Jews." Two robbers were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left.
"Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing."
Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads.
"Come down from the cross if you're the Son of God."
In the same way, the chief priests, teachers of the law, and elders mocked him.
"He saved others, but he can't save himself. Let him come down from the cross, and we will believe in him."
One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him.
"Don't you fear God? We are punished justly, for we are getting what we deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom."
"I tell you, this day you will be with me in paradise."
Grief and shame weighed down.
was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The darkness of the cross, God have mercy.
It is the darkness of my sin that shrouded the light of the world. Christ, have mercy.
From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over all the land. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?
My God, why have you abandoned me? Why are you so far away when I groan for help? Every day I call to you, my God, but you do not answer. Every night you hear my voice, but I find no relief.
Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. Our ancestors, they trusted in you, and you rescued them. They cried out to you and were saved. They trusted in you and were never disgraced.
But I am a worm and not a man. I am scorned and despised by all. Everyone who sees me mocks me. They sneer and shake their heads, saying, is this the one who relies on the Lord? Then let the Lord save him. If the Lord loves him so much, let the Lord rescue him. Do not stay so far from me, for trouble is near, and no one else can help me. My enemies surround me like a pack of dogs. An evil gang closes in on me. They have pierced my hands and feet. I can count all my bones. My enemies stare at me and gloat. They divide my garments among themselves and throw dice for my clothing.
Praise the Lord, all you who fear him. Honor him, all you descendants of Jacob. Show him reverence, all you descendants of Israel. For he has not ignored or belittled the suffering of the needy. He has not turned his back on them, but has listened to their cries for help. I will praise you in the great assembly. I will fulfill my vows in the presence of those who worship you.
The poor will eat and be satisfied. All who seek the Lord, praise him. Their hearts will rejoice with everlasting joy. The whole world will acknowledge the Lord and return to him.
He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. The darkness of desertion, God have mercy.
It is the darkness of my sin that shrouded the light of the world.
Christ, have mercy. By this time, it was noon, and darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. The light from the sun was gone, and suddenly, the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn down the middle. Then Jesus shouted,
Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.
When he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, worshipped God and said,
Surely, this was the Son of God.
When all the people who had gathered to witness the sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. But all those who knew him, including the women from Galilee, stood at a distance, waiting and watching these things.
For he was cut from the land of the living. For our transgressions he was punished. The darkness of death. God have mercy.
It is the darkness of my sin that
that shrouded the light of the world. Christ, have mercy.
Lord, I'm here again. I have grieved your heart, and once more I yielded to sin. There's no one to blame. Have disobeyed, and I've turned and gone my own way. So I ask you to forgive every time I've bound to sin. It's hard to walk in the narrow way, and I'm so quick to stumble and fall. Lord, I know choose what's wrong. How I need your power in my life. So I ask you to forgive every time I've bowed to sin. I'm weak.
Of this world, he is the light of the world, and the darkness will not overcome it.
In that light, we find forgiveness and fellowship in communion with our Lord.